Well, welcome those of you who've joined us tonight for the third episode of Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families. I'm Roy Yankee, the Executive Director for PIR Ministries, and I am joined by co-host Annie Rose, who is the Director of Ministry Support and Development for the EPC. And it's been our pleasure to launch these webinars and provide a safe space for questions about the mental health and emotional challenges that we face in ministry life. Our goal in this has been to try to begin normalizing the conversations around those things so that we can enter into a more healthy place as we serve the Lord. And tonight we are joined by Brandon Addison and Joey Sherrard. This is going to be a little different than what we've done it before, where they're going to be talking together and doing sort of an interview process. And you are always free to ask questions. Annie and I will be monitoring those. And at an appropriate place, we'll begin to ask Brandon and Joey to jump in on those and answer them. And certainly, as we get toward the end, there'll be more opportunity for that as well. So Brandon is an ordained pastor and a coach leadership specialist with TinMan Ministries. And I'm excited to know more about TinMan as we go forward. He served as a lead pastor for over a decade and church planter, and now focuses on guiding leaders and pastors and churches and organizations towards greater alignment with their purpose. He has a master's degree from Covenant Seminary and is slowly completing a doctoral thesis on leadership, neuroscience, and the practice of attunement. That's pretty cool. Brandon is in Denver, Colorado, and is married to his wife and has two children. They share a common interest because I think, as we were talking beforehand, Joey and Brandon met as they were doing whitewater river guiding. And that was pretty cool to hear about. Joey Sherrard serves as the associate pastor of discipleship at Signal Mountain Presbyterian Church. He's married to Kate, and they are raising two teenage sons. Good luck with that. He's previously served at First Presbyterian Church in Starkville, Mississippi. He is also a fellow of the Center for Pastoral Theologians and serves as a guest lecturer at Reformed Theological Seminary in Orlando. Outside of work, he is still outside, trail running and experimenting inside in the kitchen. So we're really glad to have Brandon and Joey with us. And with that, we're going to kick it off and let them take the helm from here. So Brandon, Joey, welcome.
Thanks, Roy. Thanks, Annie. Really glad to be here. And Joey, thanks for joining us as well and jumping into this.
Yeah. Thanks all. Looking forward to this conversation. And Brandon, I'm looking forward to this conversation, particularly because you have been so helpful for me in this, my own journey through the topic that we're talking about today, which has to do with shame. So maybe why this topic when you were invited to be a part of this? Why, when you think about pastors in particular, did you feel a real desire to talk about shame?
Yeah, well, there's a few reasons for that. One, it's at the very beginning of the Bible. It's like Edenic, and it's alluded to, but often, how often do we actually talk about it? Like, we've probably heard a lot of sermons and discussions of the cultural mandate and creation days, but what about the tyranny of shame? Secondly, also, it's like empirically a little bit what we did. I'm part of the Presbytery of the West. We interviewed through a survey ruling elders and teaching elders, and a couple of things surprised us. One of the surprising things is everybody thinks they're a great preacher, above average. That's just kind of funny considering the world we live in. But two, 80% of respondents said they struggled with quieting the inner critic. And so even though we have this gospel belief that we are beloved before we do anything, there's still something lurking below us, which we would call shame. More surprisingly, though, was the comments. Usually I don't like comments like on Nextdoor, the internet, but comments on anonymous surveys tell you a whole lot. And we just heard some things going, my biggest fear in ministry is my kids are gonna not believe the gospel because they see my darkness and they see my vocational stress more than they see anything else. How do I exchange true Sabbath, or how do I actually exchange alcoholism and eating junk food for actual true Sabbath? And the one that kicked it more than anything else was, the hardest place to be vulnerable in ministry is within my Presbyterian brothers and sisters. And I just began to ask the question, all these things are going on in ministry. We got theological affinity, we got relational proximity, but why can't we talk about the hard things and the true things and the human things and the things that we need to discuss and bring into the light? And partially, that's due to not having the conversation, the deeper conversation about shame. And the last one, of course, I don't want to talk about myself, but I got to talk about myself, is I realized early on in ministry, part of my work ethic and my drive and my ambition that looked really good on the outside and was accoladed in seminary, if you drilled enough into my story, it was actually motivated primarily by shame, not necessarily by freedom. So those are a few reasons that kind of brought me to the table here for this.
Yeah, that's great. That's super helpful. Yeah. Yeah. I sort of taking that big framework and moving forward, what the word shame is, one that maybe increasingly over the last few years, someone like Brene Brown or somebody like that using that kind of language has become maybe more familiar. But when you think about walking with somebody through that or helping a pastor kind of walk through their own story of shame, how do you understand it? How would you kind of help somebody get their mind and heart wrapped around that?
Yeah, that's a great question. One, Joe, you're already alluding to, and I'm really grateful for the work of Brene Brown and her research and even the TED Talk, because it actually brought shame to the forefront of research. And it's actually affirming what the biblical narrative has already talked about. And I think even if we wanted to talk shop about this, and I may want to go here too, was some of us have a theological understanding of shame that's biblically based. That's really important. But typically we don't have good practices to actually do healing work around shame. Others of us have a really therapeutically minded view of shame, which is great and needed, but also it can sometimes leave out the most powerful parts of redemption, that we are a new creation. But to give a little bit of a framework behind that, how I talk about shame, I use a couple different languages that help us recover what we're made to be. And so one is a word of like toxic shame. Now, toxic shame, like, I think we all know what toxic shame is. I mean, even experientially, I don't need to explain this. I could even go, hey, let's think back to last week. And what's a shameful moment where you felt toxic shame? And how about now everybody unmute and get online and share that moment of toxic shame? And even we have a visceral response to that, because toxic shame, what it does, it keeps us in a cycle, and we feel shame, and then we feel shame about being ashamed, and we circle in isolation. So toxic shame is like, I'm flawed, I'm broken, there's something wrong with me. And if I told you the truth about what was actually going on in my life, you would actually not want to be with me. You judge me. That's toxic shame. What we begin to see biblically, and even Adam and Eve model this, we call it healthy shame in our coaching practice, because it's a way to recover what we lost. Healthy shame is recovering our humanity. Like, even in the perfect world, like, we were made needy, dependent. We needed one another. It's not good for man and woman to be alone. That's not a marital context. That's a human design context. The tree was in the middle of the garden of evil, the garden of good and evil. Or the tree was in the middle of the garden of Eden. And wherever you walked around that tree, it was in the middle. You could see it, which reminded you of our dependency. Even Jesus models this really well in his earthly life, like healthy humanity and dependency. So toxic shame, I'm flawed, I'm a mistake, there's something wrong with me. Healthy shame is, I'm not God. I need others. I'm limited. I need help. I need relationship. And actually, my neediness is actually what's right about me. And sorry, I got one more thing. What really saddens me too is most ordained pastors, they know how to proclaim the gospel. And the gospel is fundamentally a gospel of need. I can't do it all on my own, and I need somebody outside to help me. But we're actually terrified of practicing that with our brothers and sisters.
Yeah, that's helpful. That's helpful. So I want to press in on that. Like that exact sort of like gap between theology and lived experience. But like on our way there, you know, could you maybe, for folks who are their mind hasn't caught up yet, could you just distinguish super quick between like guilt and shame?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Guilt is, hey, I did something wrong. Guilt is based upon behavior. Even we feel guilt to reach out for the freedom we can find. That's what guilt is, behavior. Shame is fundamentally based upon identity. Shame, the voice of it is, I'm fundamentally irredeemable. That's how strong it can be. And even in the brain, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to bring my thesis in because I got to bring it in somehow. So here it is. Let me bring in my thesis. I got to find at least a couple paragraphs. So the term is interpersonal neurobiology. Basically, Dan Siegel, Alan Shore, Kurt Thompson's part of this as well. Dan Siegel spent 4 years at UCLA, got all these interdisciplinary people together and go, hey, how do we actually describe the discipline of the mind? Because it's too complex, it's too beautiful to be defined by one discipline. And they began to do research on it and call it interpersonal neurobiology. What happens with shame in the brain? I'm going to connect it to driving. I got a teenager or about to start it, so it's fresh in my mind. Like what healthy brains do is they have gradual acceleration. So you think about a healthy person in the world, they find secure relationships, they begin to seek out their curiosity and explore, and they realize they're in a safe spot. That's what the brain begins to do with creativity, relationships, and connection. And then also what a healthy brain needs is what I call healthy deceleration, gradual deceleration. That means when there's a relational break, there's a rupture, you yell at your kids, there's a closed loop, somebody's like, hey, I'm so sorry I yelled at you. Or, hey, that divorce must be really challenging for you. There's closed loops. What shame does, and this is also what tanks your insurance score, is harsh breaking. The difference between gradual acceleration and deceleration is really harsh breaking. And that's what shame does in the brain. You have gradual acceleration. Somehow you feel a relational rupture. Literally the processing of the brain stops from the sympathetic nervous system, goes to the parasympathetic nervous system, and you stop in your tracks. You stop moving forward. Your attention becomes on yourself. Usually a voice of condemnation comes in. And once the voice of condemnation comes in, it goes, okay, I'm not okay. Just a show and be human. I better just put on a front. And if you don't hear the allusions to Genesis 3 and fig leaves, this is actually what neuroscience is talking about too. And then eventually what we do is we become hyper-focused on ourselves and we lose the outward theater of the world. We no longer see life for what it really is. Sorry, Joey, you got to correct me there. I just had to go monologue a little bit.
That's great. It's super great. As you're talking about that, Brandon, I'm thinking about, the picture in my mind was a pastor standing in front of a congregation anytime in the last 4 years, saying the gospel, but sort of bringing into that context all of the kind of relational, wreckage of maybe the last 4 years, the tension, all those kind of things, and the experience of proclaiming the gospel, but yet being deeply lonely, being afraid of talking about that loneliness, all those kind of things. Can you say more about, I'll just say that, sort of take that and just kind of run with it as you think about shame and interpersonal neurobiology and all that kind of stuff.
Well, I got like four or five thoughts and I already want to jump to practices to help that pastor. That's kind of where my heart is already going. It's like, let's go help that hypothetical guy you just spoke into existence, which isn't hypothetical. It's actually the majority of people we see in our life. The first, what shame does, and this is the tyranny of it, is we think we're the only one. And here's the irony as I work with clients and pastors and leaders. The things we're most scared about sharing is typically the things we have most in common. So when we begin to discuss that and name that, it actually brings us to the realm of humanity. It brings us back into connection. It brings us back into like our clumsiness. We don't have to be perfect in it. Makes me think of John, God is light. And there's I'll just stop there. I don't want to throw a Bible verse on it, but that's one component of it. Also, pastors in that scenario, there's expectations upon that person to be the spiritual leader. but at least, and this is pejorative, at least in my sense, that's usually self-imposed. Usually it's the pastor or the spouse putting some sort of expectations upon them that's self-imposed, not necessarily from a direct elder person, this high standard to lead. And if I actually show up in humanity, then people won't follow me, or they'll leave me, or they'll reject me, or worse, they'll try to fix me as opposed to be with me. Mm-hmm. So those are a couple of thoughts that come to mind.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think you've already gone here, but how does what you just said connect to like the title you gave all the, you know, unmasking the name and in our humanity?
Yep. Yeah. Well, the title intentionally, we often talk about shame as the problem, and we need to talk about shame as the problem, but we more need to talk about what shame keeps us from. And what shame keeps us from is our humanity, our dependency, our neediness, our ability to be in process. That's also called sanctification, by the way. I had a mentor say, tell me about sanctification. Brandon, on your best day, you're just a giraffe on ice. Like, that's what sanctification means. It's not perfect. It's clumsy. It's awkward. You're going to slide all over the place. That's actually what's right about you. It's not what's wrong about you. And so the reason I called it unmasking shame and moving it back is we talk about shame and the problem, but we don't talk about what we need to recover. And once we can name toxic shame, we can actually move back towards our humanity, our dependency, our neediness, our humility. That's another way to talk about it, to walk upon the ground, to be grounded.
That's great. That's great. Yeah. I want to make sure that, like, as we're talking about this, like, we get enough of the kind of big picture stuff before we move to on the ground. So, you know, anything else that you would want to say before we move on to that about signs of toxic shame, ways that somebody could maybe notice it? And then also, like, yeah, what is this, the healthy shame that you're talking about, the humility? Well, what are the kind of aroma of that in a Christian?
Well, yeah, I think one thing, and we just need to give a nod to this, and you see this in the garden. And I just want to point out a couple things theologically that are really important. First, the pinnacle of creation after Adam and Eve are named, and there it says they're naked and unashamed. Like, out of the entire richness of the biblical story and the amount of words, the writers decided for that word, not happy, content, free, full, shalom, at peace. No, unashamed. There is like a freedom of being vulnerable and being human and still holding connection. That's really right and good. And then secondly, what we see, you know, Genesis 3, Adam and Eve eat, their eyes were opened, and it says they sewed fig leaves because they knew they're vulnerable, so they had to hide themselves. They had to hide their humanity, hide their vulnerability. And then God walks in the garden, and this is what's phenomenal too. It doesn't say, well, you messed up, you're done. No, where are you? And that's not a question about latitude, longitude, or dropping a pin to find them. It's a question like, what happened to you? What happened in relationship to you and me? Like, what's come about this? It's a counseling question. It's not a condemning question. And so there's this beauty of even God moving towards ashamed humanity to help them find freedom, even at the very beginning of the biblical story. You can flash forward to like Jesus's life. He associates with shameful people, takes on the scorn and the shame of the cross. I mean, we don't need to do like a biblical theology of shame, but I just want to give some head nods to the deep biblical roots of what we have here. And even the conversation we're having, though it's at a different level, is very much in line with that.
Mm-hmm. That's great. That's super helpful. Yeah. I'd love to, as we kind of move towards thinking about practices and postures that pastors can take, I'd love for you to like maybe share a little bit about like maybe a little bit more about this, like this, the way that this has been a part of your own story and pastoral ministry and as a follower of Jesus.
Yeah. So most of us were formed by stories in our life that are age 18 and younger, and they continue on and they reenact. And that's one thing we need to realize. What stories do we continue to reenact? So some things in the rue of my life, and by the way, I don't want to share this, Joey, but I think it's appropriate just with my story and everything else related to it. One, birth order. I was born really, really premature. Really dramatic story. I was resuscitated by my mom I was resuscitated by my mom. Like, I basically had a SIDS episode. The moniker miracle child became into my play. Like, oh, you're the miracle child. You're the miracle child. You're the miracle child. You're the miracle child. I'm born 15 years younger than my sister, 10 years younger than my brother. I'm the miracle child, and I'm already kind of behind. Like, everybody's already done everything, and I'm already behind. At 16, I radically come to faith in Jesus, changes my life, rocks my world. I have a beautiful experience in college, all with unique brokenness. I blow into seminary. I go into pastoral ministry. And what do I begin to do unknowingly on autopilot? It's these unknowing messages that weren't true, that were somewhat shaming. One is, I'm a miracle child, which means you better perform and be the miracle and show up. So I knew how to work and work hard and get it done. The other is, hey, you're behind. You're behind. You better not be behind. So you always got to be ahead. You got to be ahead of people and intelligence and wit and drive. And what was challenging is nobody would be able to see that from the outside. That stuff was so buried in my story. I had to help people who've done their work help me see what was underneath it. Because typically, on a church on a Sunday morning, that's celebrated, especially at the height of the missional church movement about 10 years ago.
Yeah, that's super helpful. Yeah. And I think from what you were just talking about, I think one of the things that's maybe helpful just to name is like the presence of like religious language, theological concept, church involvement is not the light that casts out shame, but can actually be like a way of like looking it, right? You know, that there are religious forms of shame, which I think like intuitively we know that, but that can actually make escaping from it like that much more difficult and actually just makes you burrow so much deeper.
Deeper into 100%. So a couple things about it. Shames, typically it happens in relationship. So that's more of a right brain phenomena, not a left brain. And so when we say things like, oh, you shouldn't feel shame for that, or don't you know that Jesus has covered you for all your sins? It's actually not talking about the part of the brain that usually has a narrow pathway with shame. So we're just trying to basically fix it with information or intellect or theology. Or what's even scary, I actually tell somebody this, and I've told myself this too, we'll see a problem in our life and our seminary training will teach us to try to fix it on our own. And we'll just simply become what we call more informed prisoners. So we'll know actually more about the topic. We'll know how to talk about it, but we haven't actually done the deeper work to find the freedom in it. Because actually what shame needs is what God modeled in Genesis 3. Where are you? Like attunement, connection, reattachment. I just need to sit with you and understand it, maybe help you reframe it. And usually what we have to catch out of our shame, we'll develop self-protective strategies that will keep other people from us. Because my true self, like that, and my humanity is pretty vulnerable. So I'll put pieces of protection in front of it to keep you from it. And usually there's a gift to that and there's a shadow to it. So theologizing, brilliant. But there could be a shadow to that because you might have the best ideas and the illustrations, but it actually, your heart's far from it. But for me, it was achievement. I can give you achievement, wit, but you couldn't have me because I was two steps ahead of that. And that encapsulates in the loneliness. Anyway, I'm getting ahead of you. I'll pause there.
It's great. you know, we don't know who's on the call. And so this might not apply to anybody who's on the call, but it will definitely apply to people who are on the call know. I mean, when you think about this dynamic for spouses of pastors, is there something that you would maybe sort of flag for that, about not just how a pastor experiences this, but how a pastor's spouse might experience it as well?
Yeah, I have a lot of compassion for pastor's spouses. One, because they can get it on both fronts. One, they can feel shame that they themselves aren't necessarily up to the task, whatever unspoken role they have in the church. They can feel shame around that. Also, for pastors who don't have infrastructure, spiritual friendships, places to talk about what happens, usually the spouse, and this is a word from Don Guthrie, who from Covenant Seminary, the spouse usually becomes a toxic dump ground for the ministry leader. And so they're not only holding their own shame from their own brokenness of their story, now they're holding somebody else's. And usually one can't be fully attended to, so they're stuck into those spaces. So one of the practices that's already come to mind for both the pastor spouse and the pastor is where can I go with my humanity? Where can I go with my needs? Where can I go with my hopes? Where can I go with my fears? Where can I go with the longings? Where can I go with the incomplete part of my house, of my life, and talk about it? Where can I go with my theological questions that are still in process? And it's not going to MinConf because I'm still trying to work it out.
Yeah, that's helpful. Yeah. And I hope we can get into this a little bit, but just in addition to what you were just saying, Brandon, I think it's maybe helpful for people to know that shame, like in Genesis 3, like it works in systems, not just in individuals, you know? And so there's networks of shame that kind of where it can be passed on from people who, yeah, don't know how to carry it and don't know what to do with it. And so it just goes somewhere else. Yeah. Well, let's start talking about how you would begin to walk with a pastor. What guidance you would give a pastor who kind of feels like they're just kind of locked in cycles of toxic shame?
Oh, yeah. First, you're not on your own or alone. And I don't want to be pithy about that or like give a head nod to Heidelberg, but it's true. I mean, the idea, we talk about the great cloud of witnesses and we think that's all triumphalistic. When I more and more look at the Bible, I go, oh, this is a story of struggle. It's a story of struggle and pain and challenge. And that's what's normal. And sure, we know how Revelation 21 is going to end and Genesis 1 and the book ends and all that. But also just begin to normalize, you go, no, like the majority of life is to struggle with God and to struggle with life and trust He is faithful. And because we're in the midst of that, doesn't disqualify you. It actually qualifies you. I'm hammering on this a little bit, and this is an aside. I don't think as a church we know how to do lament, sadness, or even waiting well. And the more we're comfortable with that in our liturgies, the more we can actually normalize that towards the human experience, because that's the majority of the human experience. A couple things I would say to a pastor, and these are more practices than anything else. One, as you can, find somebody, regardless if it's a spiritual director, a mentor, a pastor, a coach, a therapist, who has done work around this, because they can give away what's been given to them. Because the only way we do this work is around other trusted guides and friends. Another thing I would say is, I mentioned it earlier, it's been a big proponent of my life. I've benefited from your participation in this immensely. It's spiritual friendship. And spiritual friendship isn't about what you're doing, it's about who you're becoming. It's not about the size of your church or what you're preaching on, it's where are you? And it's a place where you can actually talk about the undercurrent of your things in your life. And It's a great question to ask. Like, where's the last time you've had a chance to empty part of your bag and somebody doesn't give you advice or try to fix it? When's the last time you've gone, I've yelled at my kids again and I'm so tired of it? Or when you can say, hey, I know I've said this to you 3 or 4 times, I got to talk about this fear one more time. And people hold space and say, thank you. That is a gift. And if you find it, keep doing it. If you haven't found it, go after it. As an aside, Harvard even did a study, longitudinal, 80 years, interviewed original participants, their kids, their grandkids. They boiled it down. It's a book called The Good Life. Hey, what's the one thing that creates a flourishing life? The quality of relationships. I call that man and woman should not, it's not good for them to be alone. But as Christian people who are identities in Christ, we should be able to do that and be the most courageous and risky in relationships. Because we don't have an identity based upon that relationship. So anyway, spiritual friendship is one key practice. That's the baseline. I don't get to preach that often, so I guess I'm going to preach a little bit. I got some passion around this. I'm just going to take it. The other is to get some awareness around shaming messages. That's another practice. What typically, like toxic shame, what it is, we have a stimulus, and then all of a sudden, we have a well-worn neural pathway in our brain, and it's been run over and over again. It's like a rut in the road, and we need to catch those things. A couple of ways to catch those. One is to go do work. Go find somebody to work with. The other, this is a great thing to do. Kurt Thompson recommends this too. I would commend it to you. Hey, take an index card, a 3x5 index card. And then as you feel shame in your body, just bullet point what happened and why you felt it. And all you're trying to do there is not try to fix it. You're trying to create awareness. This is what happened. And before I have a thought or a feeling or an action about it, I'm just going to try to catch it. And if you do that enough, you will see some trends and themes through there. Awareness around shaming messages. Another practice, what I've learned in my life, it's been an unexpected gift too, is reconditioning through your children. I'm not saying using your children, but one way we actually see ourselves in kindness is through our kids, because our kids can be a mirror to us. They can also be a doorway to kindness. So two quick stories I thought of. One, so I had no idea when I was in my head reliving a Sunday I didn't like. Like it's on Tuesday and I'm driving somewhere. I would begin to use my hands in the car. And my son's like, hey, there's your pastor fidget again. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, yep, you're just in your head thinking about something that's not here. And he just said it with such kindness. And I'm like, you're absolutely right. Like, I'm trying to redo something I felt limited on, and it's keeping me from the gift of the present. That was a gift. And he just said it matter-of-factly. The second thing, and this is similarly, kids will point out your idiosyncrasies with kindness, and they'll actually be kinder to you than you are with yourself. So my kids did this last week. I didn't even know I did it. So apparently when we're disciplining our kids, my wife will say something and to like, I guess, add my two weight, I'll repeat the last four words of her sentence, you know, so big, hey, you need to take a shower and go to your room. And I'm like, and go to your room. And my kids were like, dad, why do you do that? That's not helpful at all. What are you trying to do? And they just laughed at it. And again, I had no idea what I was doing. And it was a gateway to go, even some of the silly idiosyncrasies, which we feel shame about, by the way, this is why I'm bringing it up. Our kids can teach us, even though you're goofy and awkward and do that, I still love you. I'm still with you. I'm not going anywhere. And so one great way, I think, for us to re-experience the gospel is through our children at times, so that kindness and that awareness. So anyway, those are a couple of practices that came to mind for me.
That's great. Yeah, that's great. Bringing sort of thinking about this with pastors. I guess one question would be like, what, when you work with pastors a lot with your work with TinMan, and through the presbytery, through the church health initiative. Like, what are the kind of, as you've done that work, what have been the surprising things you've noticed? Like, oh, like, I didn't expect shame to grow in these ways, in these places,
yeah,
in people's lives.
A couple things. Shame in relationships of authority. So elder-pastor dynamics, great opportunity for health connection, also the greatest source of loneliness, discontentment, and potential shame. Division over there, not understanding one another, missing one another, that's a place as well. I've seen it in pastors being honest to go, hey, our small groups do really good intellect, but we don't do life really well together, because the minute we pray, it's like everybody's brain switches and we're going to a Bible study and people are giving me the right answers and I don't want the right answers. I want to help people in their struggle and I don't know how to do it, because we've almost like conditioned people to act and operate in a certain way. I got a couple other thoughts. You want me to keep on going? I feel like this is shining a little bit of a flashlight, knowing we can't solve all of it, and hopefully it'll illuminate some things. So I'm feeling a little bit of my limitation over that. So just, you know, help me as you can. But I've seen shame even hide in our liturgies. So in two places that we really want to be mindful of in our liturgies, one, confession of sin and communion. What I've seen, if it's ritualized, a heavy confession of sin, which is honest and it we read about, but if you blow by the confession of assurance, you're actually entrenching something you don't want to entrench, a deeper awareness of sin, perhaps with not as much freedom of Christ in it. Same thing also with communion. Communion be a great time of reflection, response. It's solemn, it's sacred in our tradition. It's more than a remembrance. We believe Jesus is with us through his spirit. It's a means of grace. It's a great opportunity. You don't have to do it, but to champion, to go, hey, whatever you thought of yourself coming in, Christ has a different word for you today. Or what this meal represents is that you belong and you matter here. Those are some places where, one, I think we can battle appropriately against some of that shame. But also, if we don't do that with thoughtfulness, it actually promote toxic shame.
That's great. That's great. It's a question that you and I have not discussed beforehand. But so let me give you a scenario that I think many pastors would sort of empathize with, and then sort of invite you to kind of address that person. So some of the stuff you talked about with neuroscience, like, your brain has worn pathways to say that, probably from family of origin types stuff or some sort of experiences that say, like, if I open up and am vulnerable, like, there will be a negative consequence to that, right? So you have that sort of like neuroscience pathway, then, which somatically, like, people, you know, all of us have that experience, right? Like, it's not reflective. We just bring it, right? Then you have a pastor who thinks, if I talk about this with my spouse, I could be burdening him or her, and they're already super heavy, so I can't bring myself there. They think about an elder, you know, and they think, if I talk about this with an elder, there could be consequences for my vocation and for my job. Knowing that oftentimes a consequence of shame can bring with it like addictions, like that's something. Then you think about, well, I could talk about it at a presbytery level, right? But then fill in the blank, right? If you were to sit down with somebody like that and they were to kind of lay all these reasons out for why I should not, why th- this this call has been, this Zoom has been super helpful, but like, no way am I doing this.
Yeah.
What would you say to that man or woman?
Yeah. Well, first, I 100% get the fear and the risk, or even the brain, what I call in anxiety, is beginning to jump to conclusions about what may happen. That's part of what we do to protect ourselves. That's also can be the anxiety of our response of trying to always be ahead. And also, I want to lament, in my early ministry career, I attempted to find help and the person didn't have the aptitude or was not safe enough. And so what I felt in my disclosure is I felt abandoned. And that can occur. First, I would go intuitively, relationally, the body of Christ has safe people. I know the body of Christ has safe people because it's been around for 2,500 years. It's incredibly resilient and the Spirit's at work. I trust that because Jesus is the one who became fully vulnerable for us too and wasn't rejected. So first I would go, let's take a step back and breathe in the beauty of the gospel and the resilience of the church. Let's intuitively go, who are the safe people we can take a step towards this? And that, my friend, I can promise you is well worth the risk. Good things happen to known people. When we show up, we have fellowship with one another. And then the blood of Christ covers us from all our sin. And those people, that's the first thing I would say to them. And also this, your life is too important, too precious, regardless of ministry or not. Let's just use priesthood of all the believers to stay in hiding and shame. Isn't that what evil wants to do? Keep you alone, isolated. I'm the only one, afraid in the corner. And this is what makes me really angry about shame or toxic shame. When it takes root, it suppresses all the wonderful uniqueness about us. I mean, I wasn't going to say this. This is an aside, but I think toxic shame's mission is actually to undo God's creation. Snuff out the Imago Dei. Stop us from living a courageous vision and mission for our life and focus on this. But anyway, I think the first step, Joey, to get back to it is, I totally get it. It's worth the risk. God and his generosity has most likely placed you in proximity to some safe people. You know who those people are intuitively. The deep calls the deep. And you pick up the 10,000-pound telephone and call them.
Mm-hmm. That's good. That's super good. But I want to, there may be questions. And so one that people might ask on the Zoom. And so one last question from me for you would be getting back to one of the things you said initially, which was not that your desire is not just to like name the negative, but to like draw us to the positive and the beauty and the good. So again, not a question we talked about, but could you maybe paint a picture of the kind of like the beauty and the goodness of people who live like who have sort of left their toxic shame behind or are leaving their toxic shame behind, right? Not a one and done process, but who are leaving that behind or living into like the beauty and the goodness of vulnerability and healthy shame and humility within sessions and marriages and presbyteries and general assemblies and all of that.
That's a great, great question. Yeah. Let me speak about it like more aspirationally than I'll go to reality. Because what you're talking about, it's like the glory of God, man, is man fully alive. Westminster Confession of Faith, to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. That means to enjoy myself. I'm at home with myself, who I am. I'm at home bringing myself to others. I'm at home with my work and my vocation. That's what you're beginning to talk to. But the beauty of healthy shame is what we call too being right-sized. Like right-sized is I'm good at some things and I'm really bad at other things. I can fully admit what that is. I can own my gifts and not feel selfish over that, but also own my incompleteness and ask Jesus to be with me. Or even better yet, I can laugh at it. I'm notorious for losing my keys and my phone. I could write a whole book on places I've lost them. I have tiles everywhere. And now I can laugh at
it. I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Did I leave one in Signal Mountain? Yeah.
That's your laptop, I think, in Signal
Mountain. I did. So as an aside, my favorite one, and I mean, literally, my dad's like, you're just always this way. I was returning something to Amazon and I accidentally put my keys in the envelope and gave it to UPS. And then I got on my tile. I'm like, why is my tile at the UPS store? I was about to ship. Oh, it was my wallet. And I was about to ship my wallet across the country. And now it's like, okay, that's just a limitation of me. Like that part of my brain didn't fully form. And I'm glad I have technology to own it. There's some freedom in living rightly, both in the beauty of what you bring and the clumsiness of who you are. In fact, the more clumsy who you are, the more endearing you are, you know, because that means I'm not perfect. It's like, oh, I can be clumsy too. It gives people what this beautiful thing is, permission. That's what the early church offered to a lot of people as well. I see it in micro and micro ways all the time. And people going, even this week on Monday, this seems like a simplistic example, but it's powerful. He's like, hey, today's my birthday. It's also tax day, which is strange. But you know what I did for the first time on my birthday? Instead of just surviving the day or silently like hoping somebody would see me, I believed I belonged and mattered. And I told my best friends what I wanted. I told my small group. And they actually willingly planned a party for me. Not that I wanted that, but man, I didn't know how appreciated I was. That was him getting over his fear and toxic shame and showing up. And also telling him what he needed and what he valued. I've seen men and women recover their need for one another. Because by the way, like you want to talk about marriage, talk about the scariest place to be vulnerable. It's not at Presbytery. It's at the ground zero of covenant love. It's still the hardest place to be vulnerable. And to show up and say, I love you, I'm with you, I'm for you, I'm afraid. I had a CEO of a company with his wife 2 weeks ago, really working on connections. Like part of me wants to hug you, and I'm going to hug you. And part of me is so afraid. And he sat there and she's like, I'm so glad you did. Makes me think of another story. Church planner overseas, crushing it overseas, even writing new liturgy, powerful. He's in a Japanese culture where everybody's a workaholic. They even have a word for it. Death by working. I couldn't pronounce it, but. So even though he's doing faithful gospel ministry, his shame is telling him, you're not doing enough. You're not providing for your family. You're not working hard enough. If you're in business, then you could really do the real work. And your wife is fundamentally disappointed with you. Those are paraphrases, but that's how loud and mean and nasty shame is. So he has the courage to go to his wife. He goes, hey, will you tell me what it's like to be with me at my best and at my worst? I just want to know what it's like to be with me. Because what shame does is it distorts our narrative. She starts crying and says, you're my rock. Like, your spiritual faithfulness and presence is incredible here. And in that moment, all the stuff that he was carrying, the lies, slowly slipped away in the weight of the truth she could tell him. Personally, for me, it allowed me to have limits. The only thing I would limit is self-denying myself to overwork to try to get it right. Over-hustling. When is enough? I got to do it right. Oh, man, that illustration's not right. Oh, I'm not smart enough. Oh, I'm behind on prep. So I'm missing out on all the beauty of life. And even when I came to Colorado from my other church, I had some people sit me down and go, hey, we love you. But, like, you're a little too clean, like, can you give us more of you? We just want more of you. And me and then the work I was doing actually allowed me to show up with more of my humanity and my preaching and not just theology or illustrations or application or confidence, sometimes masked as fear. You know, I could show up as me. Even today, I mean, it's been a crazy week, a super busy week. I'm like, I'm hanging out with Joey. I'm super excited. Roy and Annie. Hey, have I done enough for this? Like, I probably like should read a book on this. I'm like, no, this is enough. I'm going to go like, literally what I did is I took my daughter on the swing. Cause I'm like, this is enough. God's enough. I got limits so I can like enjoy the gift of being present.
That's great. Thank you, Brandon. Thanks. Annie, Roy.
Wow. Such good stuff. Thanks, Brandon. Enjoy. This has been great. At this point in time, I don't see any particular questions coming from our participants. So maybe Annie and I can jump in and offer some of our own questions that we have. I wanna jump into that really dangerous place where you were talking about marriage and how difficult that is, you know, and how it can be either the blessing we hope for or the trash heap that we expect, I guess. Tell me a little bit more about that. What, you know, how do spouses, you mentioned one example, which was beautiful. Are there other things that spouses can do for one another to help get over those shame hurdles?
Well, yeah, it's, and one thing, shame hurdles is a really good analogy. As long as we're comfortable, like the race never ends to some extent. Like we'll finish the race, but it's continuous and it may look different in different seasons. One thing, as best you can, we walk around with these thoughts and these fears and we become entrapped to them. And actually the way out is to name them appropriately. So one thing is begin what we call like telling on ourselves or bringing our insides to the outside, you know, or it could be like, hey, you know, when you were giving our kids so much attention and it was late for bedtime, I hate to say this, I was a little jealous because I really want some time with you too. That's actually you modeling your neediness, showing up in vulnerability, you know. The other thing is reprocessing strange things that happen in church together. Hey, Sally came to us and she had some edge. Like what was there? And talking about that. And the reason is typically when something's off, we'll internalize it. And if there's a shame narrative there, we'll automatically attach it and make it about us. So to hold it together kind of goes, no, I don't think that was about you. I think that was about somebody else. Or she had a hard week or he had a hard week, you know? Being kind to one another. Part of me, this is pejorative, joking, but hey, let's take Proverbs 31 and the expectations upon spouses and shelf that as like the proper hermeneutical place of like aspirational discussions, but not expectations. All that also within that, the healthiest pastors I've seen are the pastors that are most home with themselves, their strengths or weaknesses, their flaws or self-awareness, who they bring into and who they bring into those discussions. So those are some places too.
That's really good. Good stuff. Annie, do we have any questions from the?
We do.
Participating?
We do. All right. Here's a question. Regarding leading staff. Let's say you lead your staff. How can you invite them more into your life, show more of your heart or neediness, be more right-sized? So specifically within the context of leading staff.
I love that question. Obviously, this stuff is caught more than taught. And so leading staff isn't just a technique. It's a process of doing your work and understanding your work. One, I would ask first, does your staff know your story and not just the biography, not the ministry greatest hits? How about the things you're proud of and the things you've stubbed your toe on? Because that'll actually give them permission when they stub their toe, we can talk about it. Because if you're not able to talk about it, they're not going to be able to bring it to you. Also is to model neediness. And neediness isn't being codependent. That's a different story. But neediness is like, hey, Julian, this week is super tight and I had a funeral come up. I really need you to help me lead this. Are you able to lead this? And that's not just a task. That's actually a relational ask. And you're beginning to model some of that. Also, are you openly willing to profess your limitations? One thing I would recommend, Zach Aswine wrote a book called The Imperfect Pastor. If you don't have it, you need to buy it. Three temptations for pastors: the everywhere for all, the know-it-all, and the fix-it-all.
Yeah.
Hey, read that chapter and then talk about in your own story the temptations and what's happened where you've been at everywhere for all, know it all, and fix it all. And then as a bonus, make a game where if you like, you fall into the trap, go, oh, I did it everywhere for all, and just laugh at yourself. Because then you're creating a staff culture where you can be human and not just be performative. I promise you, your staff needs your humanity more than they need your professionality, if that was a word. Especially in ministry, because what we're doing is we're plugging our life into an amplifier. We need more healthy, human examples. We have a ton of inhumane and tragic examples. We need more human examples.
That's good. Thank you.
Yeah.
Joey, would you want to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, I think what you said, great, Brandon. I mean, I think like it's also, I guess shame is just so subtle, you know, like, and I think that that's part of like, so I would say like the difference between like healthy shame and toxic shame can sometimes be the difference between saying, you know what, yesterday was a busy day and I just didn't get to that, on the one hand, and on the other hand saying, yesterday was a really busy day and I don't really get to that because so-and-so, you know, blew up my day, you know, which sort of begins this pattern of saying like, my limits are okay only if I can blame somebody else, you know, which just passes the shame on in the system, you know? Yeah. So I think that's part of it. Yeah. I mean, I think some of it is, yeah, we have to do our own work, you know, and when we do our own work, that means that like when we say it, like the posture and the tone will match the content of what it is that we're saying. And so that's like not an easy answer, right? It's just like, yeah, if I've done the work of handling shame in my own life, then it's like sanctification works, you know, like I become that kind of person that you talked about in the answer to the last question, like someone who doesn't just give you the words of the gospel, but who like gives you the posture and the music of the gospel. Yeah.
Good. It's good. Oh, we have another question. Again, following up on the staff piece, moving from the lead pastor or head of staff to those who are part of the staff who, as we all do, live in a very performance-oriented culture. So what would you suggest to the staff subordinates potentially swept up in that and offer them some help that doesn't celebrate, you know, the model doesn't celebrate the humanness?
Yeah, it's another good question. I'll give a couple layers of responses, and these layers of responses need to be taken gently and also with the amount of candor and not candor, but amount of trust in the organization. One thing, and it's actually healthy, is you can confront the pastor if you have enough clout respect, not even clout, peership. Confrontation is a conflict. Confrontation is, let me tell you what it's like for me to be with you. Hey, Bill, like when we're demanded to work 6 days a week, I'm really afraid we're not producing the type of people we want to produce in staff. Or we're not actually calling on people to love others well. No, that's more of a high level staff, right? That's an executive pastor, a long-term associate pastor, that's a peer. But typically the strongest leaders really respect that actually, because they're not leading in a vacuum. You develop some of it. The other component is learning to set boundaries for yourself. Like, what can you say yes or no to? I can't do that right now. I can't do this here. Hey, I know I have a bunch of responsibility this week. You want me to lead these two things? I got capacity for one. Which one is most more important? Another component towards vulnerability is don't wait in the pasture, create the space that you need to thrive. Like I'm not asking you to create a coup or another church, but find people you can connect with and be honest with and do life with and tell on yourself about. In fact, one of the reasons Joey and I are connected is about 4 years ago, we were both leading in different contexts and realizes we needed something outside of our context to make us thrive in ministry. So we formed a peer group that's been going for 4 years. Mm-hmm. But that didn't come out of this grand plan. That came out of our neediness. It's like, I'm dependent and I need something else. And it's definitely not more theology lectures or another small group paradigm. Mm-hmm. I need people who could understand what it's like to be in my shoes, who I don't have to impress. So, I mean, even for that, I would say, don't wait on the lead pastor. Don't wait on the culture to change. Go get what you need.
That's great advice. Great, great wisdom there. That's good stuff. Yeah.
Now, switching over to the spouse's side of things, what would you recommend in terms of how spouses can deal with the shaming and the expectations that can come from a church when they internally aren't called to those things?
There is power in naming. There's already an answer to that question. I'm feeling pressure and expectations, but I'm not necessarily called to that. One thing, and again, this isn't gonna solve it. So Joey said this really word, so much of shame work is below the waterline. It's hidden in shadows. It's in passive aggressive comments. Even our humor, typically we're trying to deflect from like what's right about us. It's so incisive in those areas. So some of these things, I wish there was quick fixes. There aren't quick fixes. Like even Kurt Thompson's like, hey, it's like we're draining the pool of shame, or it's like plaque. It builds up and then we flush it out again. But one thing to do, get on a whiteboard with your spouse. Independent of ministry, independent of responsibility, especially for the spouse, what has Jesus called me in this season? And bullet point it. On the other end of the whiteboard, what are all the other expectations in my life about ministry that have been given to me that are residing in my head? And write those down. And the intention is to learn to begin to release some of those, because usually they're self-imposed, so you can take hold of the true ones that are there.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing I would just say to that, and this would be to pastors and to pastor spouses, is that just to build on something that Brandon said earlier, is that you're not alone in your loneliness, right? That like, you know, the pastor's group that I'm a part of with Brandon, like we all sort of at the same time sort of came to one another and said, I need something else, which is kind of a way that we were basically saying, I'm kind of lonely right now. Right. And if pastors feel like that, then I also know that pastors' spouses feel like that, maybe even more so. And so there are ways that I would hope and pray that pastor spouses could find those same kind of things. And I know there are opportunities at things like GA for these kind of things for pastor spouses, but also there's groups like Parakaleo, which kind of really helps pastor spouses kind of find each other and think about this, the crazy role that a pastor spouse has, you know? Yeah. Lots of expectations, no authority to actually do anything, right? Yeah.
Let me follow up on that if I could, and just ask, you know, the work you suggest about identifying the expectations that are self-imposed on us. What happens when you're challenged by someone, an elder, a person in the congregation, for whom those expectations are actually verbalized, and they may or may not resonate, you know, with what you internally feel? You know, what are some options there to keep yourself from adopting that? Maybe that's not true of you.
Yeah. Yeah. And also, Roy, what you're getting into, which I think is a really important topic. It actually showed up in our survey too, is how do we actually do conflict and confrontation really well? Because typically we have comments like that and we take them on or we adopt them and then we resent the elder. And so now I've adopted it, I'm performing, but there's a relational rupture. So now like there's this relational laser in this room as we meet together, but I'm performing to make that person okay. So first thing, and this actually, by the way, this is not a hypothetical question. This is an all too typical Sabbath question in the church. So pastors have a Sabbath and then it goes, well, why do you get a Sabbath? We don't get Sabbath. And then either what happens is the pastor takes the Sabbath and there's a resentment towards an elder. The pastor works another year and then there's something happened, but there's never that relational conversation going on about actually what's happening. Because most conflict isn't about the data, it's about the process and the connection. Hmm. You know, sorry, I went on a tangent. Could you rephrase your question one more time, Roy? My apologies.
No worries. Yeah, just when pastors, because in your work and ours as well, you know, there are those times when there's an immediate connection between an external expectation that is presented. Mm-hmm. That may or may not resonate with one you already have, but how do you keep yourself from adopting that?
One thing, if it doesn't resonate, okay, that doesn't resonate. This seems really important to this person. First, I'm going to ask, hey, where's this coming from for you? This seems really important for you. And I'm asking the curious questions of, where is this in his mind? Is this part of the role that I missed? Is this what the former pastor always did and I don't do it? And we need to grieve that the pastor is different, because that's actually not an expectation conversation. That's a grieving conversation. Mm. That something's changed, you know? Is this an import from your business? So we need to separate like what business leadership and eldering does. A lot of it first, curiosity, which granted that takes a whole lot of courage to ask like, hey, what's going on with you with this? Or why is this so important to you? I don't think I can tend to this well as I want. That's me acknowledging my limitation. Can you tell me again why this is so important? So I'm acknowledging my limits that I'm seeking to understand. That's the work that we need to do within sessions and other people to kind of tie it together, to find that commonality and connection. I had this thing happen with a client with sabbatical. He was so irritated. He delayed 9 months. It happened again. Like, why are you taking a sabbatical? And he finally like, hey, I've been waiting at this thing for 9 years. I've been looking for it for me and my kids. What's this energy for you? And what came out of the elder was his own burnout and his own jealousy. Mm-hmm. And he was unknown projecting upon a pastor. Mm-hmm. So now, instead of having a Sabbath conversation, they're having a spiritual conversation about leadership. That's what happens. Now, that's a lot easier to talk about hypothetically than in reality. But a lot of times what we do in session meetings is we either try to manage a room, get through the agenda, stall some of the conversations to survive it. And what we really need to bring is bringing our insides to our outside. Because if we bring our insides to our outside, we actually show up with ourselves. And we're not trying to be dependent, codependent, or manage the room. Now, that's a different conversation, but that's where my brain is going with that.
That's good. No, really good.
So many directions I want to go. Brandon, toward the very beginning, you mentioned as part of your own story, recognizing that some of your hard work, some of your work ethic was motivated by shame. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about what are some of the signs for us that we're being motivated by toxic shame? What are some of the things that we can notice if we get curious about ourselves? What are some of the ways that we can begin to identify that shame might even be motivating some of the good things that we're doing?
Yeah. Yeah. Let me share part of out of my own story and then we can get to some of the particulars as well. One out of my own story, I was, like I already said, I was a little bit predispositioned to achievement. And even in my own story, the way I got the attention I wanted growing up was through achievement. And unknowingly, I didn't fully get this until I started unraveling it. I went and started out a church plant super early in my 30s to go after it, get it done, left church early, had some things happen in my life that actually caused me to do some deeper work. It was a deeper rescue for me. But I began to understand, and all of that work, mission, gospel, unreached people group, story, all that's there. And the prospectus was genuine. And then yet underneath the waterline is, I got to be faster than my peers because I'm behind. And I better be somewhat impressive and novel. And that motivation was right there too. Mm-hmm. And usually in our callings, there's evidence of beauty. And there's also part of our brokenness that calls us into ministry. That could be shame, fear, attention, got to be right, nurturing. And we have to understand what that is. We have to get after some of that collectively. As far as shame goes, so we're the only animals to my knowledge that blush, that have like these physiological responses sometimes to these things. So first, the question is, hey, when I feel shame, which we all know what that feels like, where do I feel it on my body? When I feel it, what's the thought going in my head? What's the lie about that? What's not true about that? And beginning to slow down on some of that work. Yeah. Hey, what are the looping thoughts that are in my head? You have them. You may have to ask somebody about them. But what are the things that constantly kind of come up in my head? When you daydream, notice what are you trying to run away from? I'm for daydreaming, but usually daydreaming is trying to get out of reality. So what are you trying to run away from? There's some things there. Where are you prone to not be human? Is it in your work? Is it your parenting? Is it in your study? Is it with your body? Where are you prone to exit your humanity, either overwork or have this deep form of inner critic? It's a lot of it is slowing down and noticing. One thing we do at TinMan, and this is not a commercial for TinMan at all, but one of the things we do within our work is we teach people an emotional language and we go through some of the most harder stories in their personal life and in their leadership, because what is unearthed out of that is usually the pains and the shame and the impairments that are still plaguing us. Mm. And have somebody to bear witness to us in that and to help reframe where maybe something has warped our narrative about what's true about us is immensely powerful. I would also say this, what we say at TinMan, when we are in the grips of shame, what we actually need is attunement. And attunement is somebody actually, Dan Siegel calls it feeling felt from the inside. That's a little weird language, but it's somebody actually paying attention to me. And attunement happens in a myriad of ways. I remember I was about to go lead a retreat, and one of the participants was like, hey, I want you to bring your brain, but I want you to bring all your heart because you got a whole lot to bring. And I wept over that because he was attuning to me and calling forth what was right about me. That was helping me right size. Mm-hmm. I had an intern at some point in time, and this is what attunement can do. I was so passionate. You guys kind of see some of that. I get messy and talk with my hands and so passionate about something. And my pastoral resident is like, our church needs more of your anger. He was attuning and saying what was true. Because my shame was telling me, you're too much. You're too big. You're not going to deal with others. You're going to ruffle people's feathers. Just be kind and preach that 25 to 30 minute sermon. Sorry, Annie, again, I got a little ahead over my skis with my thoughts. I'll pause there if you got any follow-ups, though.
I like it. No, I thought it was great. And I especially, I appreciated the language around paying attention to where you're trying to be more than human in different areas of your life, mm-hmm. you know, where you're kind of trying to throw off your limitations. I think that's really helpful to ponder.
Yeah.
Yeah. Any thoughts that you have on that, Joy? Want to jump in here?
No. Well, yeah. I mean, I think even just to maybe just to a great way to just really think about what Annie just talked about is like, do you take a Sabbath? Like, do you feel permission to take a day of rest from work, or does work kind of creep in on that? I think the presence of like addictive behavior is a great example, because addictive behavior can be a way that we're trying to manage toxic shame within ourselves. An inability to let go of mistakes, right? So, you know, the kind of like post, not like just post meeting, but like, you know, a week later, I'm still running over my head, like, gosh, I wish I had said that differently. Or, I can't believe I said that. Or I can't believe I did, you know, that way of kind of rehearsing that is, you know, for me, a way of saying like, I can't make mistakes. This is not allowed. You know, that's a sign for me of that as well. Yeah.
Joey, that makes me think of an acronym sometimes we use for the toxic side of shame is should have mastered everything, should have already mastered everything. And that's what, oh, I should have done it differently, or should have known better, or should. That's a great tell that you're likely in shame.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, even just like, particularly for pastors, when you show up at like a presbytery meeting, like toxic shame is like, the flip side of toxic shame can be like a form of shamelessness, right? Like, I've got to be better than everybody else. And so like, can I just say like, you know what? Brandon's just better at this than me, you know, like, and I celebrate that because I don't have to be the entire body of Christ to everybody, you know?
Yeah. Maybe the body of Christ was us accepting our limits. Maybe that was the illustration, you know, it's modeled really well in Jesus's life. Sabbath breaks, running away, expressing his needs and feelings, but
yeah, that's good. So this probably, I don't know, we've got a few more minutes. So this was a question that occurred to me. So in our general culture, we are performance oriented. And of course, there's all of the ideas in social media about fear of missing out. Can you tie that into the shame discussion in terms of being the tendency to be over connected in those kinds of spaces, and how that might reflect some of those challenges that we have, or the expression of shame?
I'll tell you where I'm going with this. In our current cultural moment, embracing limits isn't necessarily in vogue. What I typically see is we want to defy limits. You think about that in multiple different ways. Like me being, I'm a mid 40s, like my Instagram handle for supplements is off. It's crazy. The algorithm are trying to sell me on things like, you know, don't embrace limits. Also the idea of like YOLO, you only live once, do what you love. FOMO, two things. I think what's scary about those, one, it doesn't allow us to be limited to human. I got to like maximize everything. And now it's the fear I'm not maximizing it because I'm going to compare my life to somebody else and it's going to feel, I'm going to feel shame or sadness or fear over that. And so that's like in the cycle, you know. The second thing too, if that's all true, that mantra, like do what you love, fear of missing out, you only live once. We live in a really scarce universe because it's all up to me. And so when I go to that, if I got to maximize everything, well, God must not be very gracious, abundant, good, everlasting. The new heavens and new earth aren't fully real. Then that's just in a, some sort of fairy tale. So I do think those things can totally get us in a shame cycle because we look outside and compare our life to somebody else's and believe the best about their life, the worst about ours. And then we say, there's something wrong with me. And you wonder why teenagers, it's a cycle, high point of depression and anxiety in our current moment.
It's good. Are there any other, those of you who are watching, any questions that come to mind before we wrap it up?
I wanted to point out, Brandon, at one point you were talking about, you know, the importance of spiritual friendship and the importance of just those relational connections in terms of overcoming our shame, because toxic shame isolates us and keeps us in that spiral of thinking that we're the only ones. What's some guidance that you would give someone who really wants to go about intentionally forming some spiritual friendships for mutual upbuilding and just to be able to live in the freedom that Christ wants for us?
Yep. There's not a map for this. And we know spiritual friendship is different than perhaps what we experience in other Christian community, like small groups and Bible studies. First, like Joey said, I would embrace your loneliness. Your loneliness is not what's wrong about you. It's right. It means you're made in relationship for relationship. It all depends on where your loneliness is leading you, where it's taking you. And then as in a personal antidote, I remember I was transferring into the EPC and I'm like, I don't want to remake friends. I need to find some guys. And I forgot what I asked Joey. I didn't ask Joey, will you be my spiritual friend? I think we just started hanging out. You know, don't make it weird, but we started hanging out. And then here's the beauty of humanity. We go into the world looking for eyes, looking for us. And we look for people who can not only understand us, but are at least know what it's like to be in our shoes. And we begin to trust some of that. And most of us likely have those friends around us, and we're maybe afraid of taking the next step. And I would go, what would be a more intentional, risky step? One thing we did that was really helpful for us, I'm not prescribing this, but I think it laid the foundation. When we started meeting as a group of people, we used a resource called the Voice of the Heart, which is the 8 core emotions. And we began to develop a rule of psalm reading, but then we would check in with our emotional lives and then share what was going on with our emotional lives. And part of it was this, is it was a corrective against, as pastors, we know we can talk about our intellect. We can know we can talk about the Bible. We can know we can even talk about our wit, but we want to talk about what's actually going on at the surface of our lives. because I think God wants us to be honest. That was a great resource for us to keep away from some of the places that we may get stuck. And usually we get stuck around sarcasm, humor, intellect, or just simply what we're doing. So take a friend out to coffee and go, hey, what are you like passionate about in life right now? What are the unanswered questions you're asking about God? If you could paint a picture in 5 years, who are you becoming? Ask those questions and just see what you feel like coming out of that conversation. Those would be a couple different early ideas. Can I bring Joey in on this too? Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Yep, go for it.
Yeah, I think, Brandon mentioned some of it in just kind of what he called picking up the 10,000 pound telephone. You know, I think with those questions that Brandon just asked is, you know, also I think the key moments in the pastor's group that Brandon and I are part of are usually when one of us takes a risk and says, this is where I am. And we find that usually when we do that, somebody else is like, me too. Like, absolutely, 100%. And I think that's what has brought us close. And so, you know, you're wise about this when you think about relationships, you know, but the questions that we get often in pastoral ministry, how's the church going? You know, there are some ways, and it's wise to say what we normally say, but there's other places where I think where we could say, you know, it's been tough. And let me get specific about the toughness. And that, you know, the other person is either coming out of a phase like that, like, or is in it right now, or we'll soon be in it, right? That's just the nature of life in a fallen world. And so, yeah. And then I think what we have done in our group together is we've just committed to being and walking with each other and just regularly being in touch with one another. And so on a weekly basis, we're in touch with one another. And then outside of that, we'll just pick up the phone when we're driving or something like that and just be like, this is what's going on with me right now. And it's not, what we've learned to do is not to try to fix each other, not to be, oh, like, have you read this book, you know, or something like that, but to say, you know, we just kind of listen. We'll be like, we'll sort of reflect back. And then, hey, do you need anything around that? You know? And then, but oftentimes we just need to talk about it. Like, and some of it's just sort of finding ourselves, like playing the, you know, where are you question. And some of it's just like, am I crazy? Like, this doesn't feel right. You know, I feel like there's something better. Like, and yeah, it's made all the difference in the world for me to have those kind of friendships. Yeah.
Excellent.
And I would just say with that, we did a short workshop in GA a couple years ago on this. And one thing we've been really cautious of, we don't have the recipe on it or the market. We just knew how to take the first steps and it emerged for us. As Joey said, I think any relational depth, it starts with a risky step. That's individually, that's with a small group, that's with your elders. And usually the risky step isn't, come on guys, let's get it together. It's like, no, let me tell you a little bit of what's going on with me. Mm-hmm. And I need you guys to listen a little bit, just hold space.
Yeah. So at the risk of offering fix-its, we did have one question that came at the very end here, and you know, it goes to, is there one scripture or psalm that you would encourage people to marinate on in regard to this? One that helps them hear the voice of the Lord over them and his love for them. Has there been one for either one of you that just kind of really sticks out that you go to? It's like your go-to reminder kind of thing.
Yeah, I got one and then something else too. And I think it stimulates from, and it's been with me for about a year ever since I went to Israel and seeing the Jordan River. And granted, this is coming out of the brokenness and the incompleteness of my own story, but it's always the baptism of Jesus. like, you're my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. And that happens before he publicly did anything is a unique balm to my soul, a gentle corrective. That's, and I think it's important to have one, because we'll get triggered or we'll get out of sorts, or all of a sudden our toxic chain's driving it, and we need scripture to remind us of what's true. So that's one that comes for me.
Yeah, what comes to mind for me right now is maybe less of one that's sort of like for meditation, and one that's more like performative is like Psalm 32. When I was thinking about the movement the psalmist goes from, you know, sort of proclaiming, blessed is the man in whom there is no, you know, who against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, but when I kept silent, like my bones
wasted away,
you know, but then I acknowledged my sin to you. And that movement, you know, sort of out of darkness and into light, out of isolation and into, that's one that, like, it just holds a promise, I think, that is one I need to be reminded of.
Thank you both so much for sharing that. Oh, Brandon, were you about to say something else?
No, I was just going to say one other thing. I think Joey modeled this well. The Psalms really speak to this pretty well. I was going to read Psalm 142. I don't need to, but the idea of the Psalms are teaching us to live life honestly before God and other people. Mm-hmm. That God wants our honesty. Like, there's no one here who cares for me. My soul wastes away. In you, I find my refuge. And learning to do that vertically, but also doing that appropriately in community. Like, that's the movement we need to take relationally. So.
Mm-hmm. That's good. That's good. Yeah, I just to share one that's been really helpful for me in the last season. During my last prayer retreat that I went on, the Lord drew my attention to Galatians 2:20. It's the, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So it's helpful for me in many, many different ways that I won't take time to go into, but I do think it's a gift when the Lord really knits your heart to a passage of scripture that you can then call to mind anytime you start to wander, start going down the trail of shame or anxiety or whatever it might be. Well, we are out of time for tonight, but this has been such a rich discussion. Roy, thank you so much for hosting tonight. Thank you to PIR Ministries for this just fabulous partnership we have to support our pastors and their spouses in the EPC. Brandon and Joey, thank you so much for being with us, sharing a bit of your journey with us. And we're really blessed by the friendship that you have modeled for all of us in the EPC. Just what a beautiful gift that's been for you and now for all of us as well. Brothers and sisters, we want to remind you that this Healthy Pastors, Healthy Family series is ongoing. So we have our next installment on Wednesday, May 1st coming up. The topic that evening is going to be really well connected to what we've been discussing tonight. The topic for May 1st is healthy relationships are as important as good theology. So we'll be joined by Fred Leon and Beth Filston for that evening. I included the link to register in your chat tonight. Please go ahead, go online and check out tinmanministries.org and pirministries.org for more support and resources. But again, I want to thank the three of you for being here tonight, and God bless you all. Go in God's grace and peace.
Thanks, Brandon. Enjoy.
Thanks, Thank you.